Hey folks, how's it going? Welcome back to the channel, and let me ask you a question. What happens when you can't beat them? Join them. But before we get to the video proper, I do, as always, want to give a big thank you to those of you who shared last week's video over on Twitter. At Bubblubber, at DCherryWolf, at YoshiroDomain, at AndsOff97, at Janeme, at Sirius9752, at Blue Rose Enigma, at KatadiaZol2, at KurokaShiro, and at IsuOkami. Thank you all so much for sharing last week's video over on Twitter, everybody. And if you too would like to have your name shouted out in next week's Hamefura video, then be sure to share this video around on the internet and then tag me at JojoTalksToMuch over on Twitter, and I will be sure to shout your name out in next week's video. Oh my goodness! Ladies and gentlemen, the time has finally arrived. It is time for the grand entrance of the Bringer of Doom, and she happens to be the most adorable Bringer of Doom I have ever seen. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, that's right. We have finally arrived at the grand entrance for Maria Campbell. Maria has finally entered the game. If you don't remember who Maria is, she's the protagonist who has come to spell doom for our protagonist, Katarina. She is the main character of the game, the visual novel, Fortune Lover, I believe I got that right, that the world is based off of. And so we actually get to see Maria here, and as opposed to normal where I save my thoughts on the character design for the end, let's just go ahead and right off the top talk a little bit about some color design, specifically color, because the character design doesn't really leave too much, but it's also important that it doesn't leave too much. But before we get into that, let's go ahead and talk about the color. The color is perfect. Mainly, Maria is clad mostly in pink. Like, it's almost all pink and white. And now, like, the white we've talked about in the past. Like, white is a very pure sort of color. It's a very, like, openly nice color. But the pink is where I want to, like, specifically focus on. Because a lot of people just see pink and they assume girl. Which, like, yeah, fine, whatever. It's a typically feminine color if you want to go into, like that area. But I think it's the reason why I think pink is specifically used here is because pink is typically a very, like, sort of kind color. It's typically associated with kindness and specifically romance. Pink is a very romantic color, very emotional, like very in tune with its emotions, which can be a negative thing, but I choose to view like having emotion, especially when it comes to color, as a good thing. And so we can see that to an extent, this does mirror Maria a little bit, right? Now, the romantic side I'll get into in just a sec, but the sort of timid and shy nature, the emotional nature of pink is very much represented in Maria. She's a shy character, like she's willing to talk to people, she's not above that, but she does sort of, she's keeping herself at a distance. She's a commoner amongst nobles. This is very, obviously very new to her, and she's kind of struggling with that. We see that very much in the pink color choice. And it's also sort of a color choice that, again, we associate it not only with kindness, but romance, and also a sort of sense of comfort and a calming nature. When you see pink, especially like pink walls, pink shirts, pink whatever, it's a calming color. It's a sort of disarming color. It puts you at ease. This is important. Why? Well, I'll tell you why. The reason why it's important that the protagonist of Fortune Lover is clad in pink is because A, she's where all the romance is going to be coming from, supposedly, until our Katarina showed up. She is supposed to be the romantic interest of all these dudes, so hence she's clad in pink. And she is meant to comfort and calm these dudes, again, hence the pink. As opposed for the actual design that the pink dress is accompanying, it's kinda just there. Maria on the surface, take the colors away and just look at the line art, she's sort of generic, right? Like, you almost sort of be like, okay, so she's wearing a sort of plain dress, plain clothes, plain hair. She just kind of looks plain, right? That's the point. Especially when it comes to, like, the Otome games, right? Otome games typically feature sort of plain Jane protagonists. Why? So you can put yourself in their shoes. It's the reason why Link doesn't talk in Legend of Zelda. It's the reason why so many, like, shonen protagonists sort of just have, like, black hair and just sort of look plain. It's so that you can inhabit that character, so you can see yourself in that character design. That's why Maria looks the way she does. I will say, though, that they do remember that she's supposed to be pretty and cute to win over these dudes' hearts. And immediately you get that, not so much from the character design, although you do get that from the character design, because again, even though she's a bit of a plain Jane, Maria's super freaking cute. But it's also the fact that her personality really matches that. We get why these people fall for her, because she's so freaking sweet. That's how you win the game, so that's how Maria is behaving. And I think the fact that her outfit and her design are plain Jane not only fits because of the Otome game thing, but it also fits because she's a commoner. She's amongst nobles, so of course she's gonna look more plain than usual. Honestly, Maria's friggin' cute. Like, she's a 10 out of 10 cutie. But she's surrounded by nobles, so of course, by comparison to their crazy dresses and crazy attire, she's gonna kinda stand out because she doesn't quite look the same as everybody else. And I think that's the point. She's not supposed to look as fabulous and extravagant as the other characters, because she's the main character and she's a commoner. So I think on a design front, Maria might be the best design in the show. A show full of designs that I've loved. You guys have heard me gush about the colors, you've heard me gush about the designs. I genuinely think Maria's the best one, and I'm shocked to say that. I mean, personally, I like Maria's design the best. Now, let's go ahead and go through the episode, shall we? I just want to talk about Maria a little bit more, because listen, Maria, like, the whole purpose of her character is that she sweeps people off her feet. I ain't gonna lie to you, when I watch this, I'm like, oh, I get why. She is so nice. Like, she's just, like, she giving me mad Toru vibes right now, where I'm like, I will defend this thing's honor. I'm not necessarily, like, romantically swayed or anything. But I'm saying that, like, I think I'm viewing her in the same way that our Keith is viewing her, where she's like, no, she's just a nice girl. I will protect that smile. That's how I feel about Maria. So by the time those bullies showed up, I was like, ooh, and Katarina shows up and I'm like, yes, because I kind of ship it, but we'll get there. The main thing that I want to talk about in regards to Maria, outside of the design and the Katarina thing, this is the thing that interests me, right? Is how quickly she starts sweeping people off her feet. Now, we assumed, at least I assumed, and maybe my fellow anime onlys, I know you light novel fans, you guys know more than us, but you guys have been very kind about not saying anything. And I'll say that I assumed that the time between going to the magic high school to when Katarina woke up, like, and realized who she was, I had assumed that the actions that took place would have grander ramifications than they did. Maria said no. Maria said, them's my boys. That's my harem. And so she starts winning these dudes over. Gerald, or Gerudo, as you guys have pointed out in the comments. Why doesn't he say it Gerudo? Because it's pronounced Gerald. You weebs. But Gerald is won over almost immediately, as he is in the original game. But Gerald, in fairness, didn't really change much when meeting Katarina. He thinks she's a little bit more quirky than he originally did. Probably thinks she's a little bit more sweeter than he originally did. But Gerald, to me, and maybe I'm off base, but the fact that he falls for Maria, and when he spots Katarina and Maria towards the end of the episode, is Gerald gonna be the antagonist? Is Gerald the villain? Is Gerald the new, like, de facto villain? Is he gonna be the antagonist of the series? Ah! It's a cool concept. I don't know if it's true. I think he's just gonna be part of the harem. But it's kind of fun to speculate, right? Like, is he gonna be, like, jealous? And, like, is he gonna try to get in the way? I don't know. But it made me way more curious about Gerald. If you can't, like, I don't know if you can hear my smile. Like, you know how you can hear a smile? I am smiling ear to ear right now, because the concept of this cast, like, is so fun. Like, the fact that they managed to continue to be so interesting in new ways. Like, Gerald has always been kind of, like, he was always sort of like, oh, like, holier than thou, you know, like, oh, Katarina, like, you must behave, blah, blah, blah. But now he's got, like, kind of a mean streak going on when we're reintroduced to him. They even say, like, in the little, like, hall of Katarina's, like, the board meeting, they're like, yeah, he kind of became the smug prince he was from the game. That didn't really change it. I'm like, yeah. But because he became the smug prince from the game, is that going to make him the villain in this new set of circumstances? I don't know. I just know that I'm interested in if that happens, or if he's going to try to... I don't know. But I find that whole aspect interesting. Let's talk about Keith. She also kind of wins over Keith, but not quite. I think she wins over Keith in as much as, like, a sort of, like, hey, you're really pretty, and we have chemistry, but it's not like a romantic thing. I just think you're cool, and I want to protect you. That's sort of where I'm at with Maria as well. I'm just like, Maria, I want to see good things happen to Maria. She's immediately a super charming character, and I want good things to happen to her. I think Keith feels the same, where he meets her, and he's like, she's pretty cool. I hope that the other nobles don't pick on her. Like, because our Keith is a good boy, he's a good lad, and I don't want anything bad to happen to Keith either. But like, I appreciate that they still try to incorporate the playboy Keith into things, right? And we specifically see, because the way that they meet is supposed to be Keith hits on her and then picks up the handkerchief and then brings the handkerchief back to her. He never hits on her, but the handkerchief thing still happens. So things are still happening, even though characters are behaving in slightly different ways. I will say, though, the one character who seems to have broken this is Alan, which was a surprise. Now, Alan, and I feel bad because my boy Keith, but like, Alan in this episode was making strong plays for a best boy candidate. Like, my boy was really, really pushing to be like, I could be a best boy. It does help when you have Tatsuhisa Suzuki as your seiyuu, and if you don't know who that is, it's my husbando. It's Makoto and Prosciutto, and he voices all my husbandos. But here he's voicing a best boy candidate. Here he's voicing Alan Stewart, and Alan Stewart is making a play for best boy. Like, when he, like, sees, like, the board, and Katarina's like, oh, yeah, like, okay, so in the game, Alan starts to see Maria as, like, a rival, so that's how they're dynamic starts, but Katarina's Alan's rival. So, like, how does he see this now? And because Katarina not only got rid of the weird complex he had against his brother, but because she's his rival, and because she's actually helped him grow into a genuinely, like, kind-hearted dude. Like, not so much kind-hearted. He's willing to, like, laugh at Katarina at one point when he sees her in her gardening outfit, and we'll get there. But, like, he's more open to being himself. He's not quite so aggressive towards other people, and because of that, he's open with his whole, like, remember he played the piano, like, a while back, and he was really, really good at it. So they kind of open that chest open, and they sort of say that instead of him being, like, upset that this commoner, this Maria, has beaten him and had gotten a higher score than him, he didn't give a shit. Like, he don't care. Alan don't care. Alan's more interested in this recital that he's putting on, and he really wants Katarina to be there. And I was like, oh shit, I kind of ship this. Not only do I kind of ship this, I really ship this. I was surprised. I was like, man, Alan and Katarina are kind of adorable, and I wasn't expecting that. And Alan, like, growing in such a short span of time, like, what, like, two episodes, like, since we were properly met him to now, like, a really short span of time. But immediately I was like, man, Alan really grew up, and he's a cool character, and I'm kind of debating whether or not he's best boy. But if he's best boy, who's best girl, and what's best ship? I don't know. A lot of questions. Anyway, speaking of best ship, let's go ahead and talk about it. Okay, so they meet in the hall. Although it's not like, it's not so much the first meeting, it's the first crossing of the paths. Like, the paths cross. And God love the team behind this show. Silverlink just crushing it, man. Like, when Katarina sees her, the world stops. Everything stops, because she's like, I'm not seeing her as this cute, plucky protagonist. I'm seeing her as this, like, cause for my destruction. And she sees her, and Maria sees Katarina, and they just lock eyes for just a sec, and then all the other characters in that hallway fade away, and it's just the two of them, and it's, like, the color, like, the saturation gets dialed down. It's a brilliant scene. And so I was like, damn, like, they kind of make Maria, like, almost, like, not nefarious by her own design, but nefarious in the actions that will take place if Katarina can't counter them. So it made it really, really interesting. And I'm thinking, like, oh, is she gonna be, like, a rival character? I thought she was gonna be, like, part of the harem. Nah, she's part of the harem, which is, like, good. That's what I wanted. But it was still a great scene. And, like, again, Silverlink just absolutely crushing this. Like this adaptation. I mean, in fairness, I don't care about light novels. I don't care about manga. I just care about anime. So I can't speak to how it's adapting the light novel, but I can tell you, as an anime, standing alone as an anime only, this is fantastic. And the thing is, I assumed that the only real meeting, between the two was going to be when Katarina compliments Maria on the muffins that she made, right? Because it's like, oh, it's this sweet little moment where, like, Katarina's like, hey, like, I really like the muffins that you baked. Like, that's awesome. Like, I miss the sweets that I used to have at my estate. And it's sweet. It's clear that they've already met before. So it's like, oh, okay, so we didn't really get to see their first meeting. Like, we kind of got to see, like, them crossing paths for the first time. But I guess we don't really get to see, like, how they properly met, since she already knows, Maria already knows who Katarina is. So it's like, okay, we didn't get to see that, weird choice, but okay. And I'm thinking, like, that's the only introduction or the only meeting that they're going to have in the episode. And then, like, we'll get more later. But no, we actually get to have this huge moment where Katarina comes to Maria's rescue from these girls who are bullying her. And one of them is very clearly taking the place of Katarina. It's, again, because we're living in an otome game, the universe has to play this story out, so it's just gonna move characters around to be where they need to be. So, this leads to Katarina defending Maria, not only because she wants the muffins, because she's like, the muffins, no, which is very Bacarina. Again, this is why people call you Bacarina. But, like, so she wants to not only save the muffins, but also she's like, that's a sweet girl, like, why are you guys being such jerks? Like, so she jumps in the way, defends Maria, and inadvertently ends up taking the place of Gerald. It's why I opened this video by saying, what do you do when you can't beat him? Join him. What do you do when you can't stop Doom from coming? Make your own damn path. This might as well, this show should have just been called Just Monica. Because I swear to G, Katarina basically became Monica. She's like, if I can't get my own route, I'll make my own route. It's super funny. Super sweet. There's tons of other stuff that I want to talk about in regards to this episode, but unfortunately I gotta run. The only other thing that I really want to address is that we see the student council president in this week's episode, and his name is Sirius Deke. Sirius Deke. His name is Sirius Dick. I'm such a child, I'm sorry. With that said, everybody, I'm gonna wrap up today's video. I hope you guys enjoyed. Question of the day today, who is your best boy and best girl? They don't necessarily have to be your favorite chip, just who is your best boy, best girl? Let me know in them comments. And that's gonna do it for today's video, everybody. So I hope you guys enjoyed. If you did, then by all means, hitting that like button and leaving a comment down below is a great way to help out this channel as it pleases the almighty YouTube algorithm. So if you choose to do so, kudos to you. And if you're feeling extra supportive today, you can go ahead and check out all the links in the description. One goes to my Twitter, another one is to our Discord server, another one to our merch store if you feel like grabbing yourself a mug, and of course, our Patreon page. And speaking of the Patreon page, I do want to give a big thank you to those of you in the T Squadron who support this channel month to month. Let's go ahead and do the Earl Grey shoutouts. iZevi, Andrew W, Branson C, Bria Rose, Calvin A, Crowbar of Irony, Daniel G, Digger the Fox, Dominic G, Emily, Ionos, Urza, Ginkotaku, Godzilla Fan, No For Nothing, Maria T, Marshall B, Mater, Mirth Mouser, Cell, Shadow Creative, Steven G, Sakochi, The Suavest Orange, Tristan G, and Veridin. Thanks so much for your continued support over on Patreon, everybody. And if you too would like to join the T Squadron, then be sure to check out the first link in the description to check out our Patreon page. That is a huge way to support the channel. And again, be sure to check out the other stuff in the Discord as well. Go join our Discord. It is now public. You can all join. Everybody can hop in the Discord. Follow me on Twitter if you want me to ramble at you even more. And until next time, you stay classy, AnnieTube, and wash your dang hands.